Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart words of life, words of hope. Give us strength, help us cope in this world.
Let's be seated. I want to appreciate the Lord for this privilege to be in your midst this morning. I want to thank our brother and sister Olaumenya Duruja. It's like the Yoruba people say Oruko Oma. You know, people always answer to their names. And from the preambles, the opening charge, the introduction, you will see that one Duroja ni Luto. Can't you see them fighting for the truth? Hallelujah. So we thank God for the privilege of knowing them. And since we have done, it's been wonderful. Wonderful. They are very zealous for the Lord. They are hungry for the truth. They want to learn. They want to know the Lord more and more. And that quest to know the Lord will satisfy it more than ever before in your life in Jesus. We thank you for putting this program together. Thank God for what the Lord is using you to do here. And for all of us that have been here, I welcome you. You've not come to see an individual. You have come to meet with Jesus. I want to appreciate my sisters and friends, the members of the New Testament Christian Mission Lagos that have left their own church and their programs for today to be here to share fellowship with us. NTCM Lagos, can I see you? Can I see the... Oh, you are welcome in Jesus' name. So, they have their program. Please be seated. So, but some of the women just... The pastor mobilized them that they have to be here to share fellowship. And my bishop, that's Brother J.K.D. Adeleye, the pastor in charge of NTCM Lagos. Bishop, now... You know why I call him Bishop? You know, some of you will be looking, Bishop, will you call me chain in Lorum? He doesn't have a chain on his neck. No cross, no cap on the head. Hallelujah. But if you go through the scriptures, it's with the church, the fallen church, that has taken these titles to become a mighty thing today. A bishop simply means an elder. A pastor, a work, somebody that is looking after the people of God. So, because he's looking after the people of God in Lagos, I call him my bishop. That's the bishop of Lagos. So he doesn't have a cap, he doesn't have any cross on his head, because Jesus Christ has left the cross and gone to heaven. Hallelujah. So you are welcome. He has about 16 branches under him. I mean, 16 or 17? 16 branches under him in Lagos. I'm not here to introduce NTCM, but I just want to appreciate. They came all the way yesterday. In fact, I was surprised to see him at the airport to receive me because they come from Egbe. He is the one in Egbe. You know how far Egbe is to this place? But they came to honor the Lord. And that's my sister, the wife, the humble wife, Shola Adeleye. You are welcome. And my brother here, I call him my prophet. He doesn't see visions, though. But he sees the vision of Christ very, very well. Well, his name is Elijah. That's why I call him prophet. He's engineer Elijah Akinyodi. Put your hands together for Jesus, for the Lord in his life. He's pastoring one of our churches in Ibadan. And he's staying here now because of this program. He's supposed to be in Ibadan with his own sheep. So, but he said, Mommy, you can't be here holding a program and I will be there. Let the people there have handed over. They will continue to do the job. So, thank God that he's not the prophet of fire. Yeah, you know, many of us, we love the prophet of fire, isn't it? But, you know, Jesus rebuked people that wanted that spirit in the Bible. And many of us remember, John and James, when Jesus was to pass through Samaria, and they refused him, James and John said, look, let's call fire down. And destroy this is we say, have you forgotten the kind of spirit that you have? You are New Testament children. You are, hallelujah, you are messengers of love and grace, not of law and fire. Hallelujah. So, We used to trick him, say, I beg, are you going to call fire down from heaven on us? He said, no, he doesn't do it again. It was in the Old Testament. So I welcome you, my brother. The wife is holding forth in the Ibadan. I welcome all of you. You are wonderful people, beautiful faces, daughters of Zion. My prayer for you is that you will fulfill your destiny in Jesus' name. You know, I could feel the pulse of the convener of this meeting, brother and sister Duroja, the burden for the knowledge of God. God will satisfy that knowledge, that burden. He will fill it, he will fulfill it in the name of Jesus. And I have good news for you. Before I share the good news, I bring you greetings from my husband. He loved to be here. I said, I wish I can follow you. But it's not possible because we are always together anywhere we go to minister. But we are having a citywide crusade coming up very soon in Ilorin at the stadium. And today, they are mobilizing all our churches in Ilorin to discuss a lot more about the preparation. So he said, I should greet all of you. And his spirit is here. You know, he's with us in the spirit. And I know that he's praying for you. He prayed with me yesterday night by this program. He prayed with me before I left. He prayed with me this morning that the Lord will do something great in your life. Something you will never forget in the name of Jesus Christ. So I said, as our brother and sister were sharing their body, God gave me a word for you. And I think it's in Isaiah chapter 11, verse 6. It's a prophecy. And I'm going to sing it in song. He said, it shall flow like a river. It shall fall like the rain. It shall rise as a dawn in glory o'er the land. For the knowledge of the Lord shall fill all the earth, and the Spirit of the Lord shall flow. Let's be on our feet and pray together as we start. Father, we want to thank you very much for bringing us this way this morning. And for this day that you have set apart, to reach down unto your children in a way to open our eyes so that we can see you better, so that we can know you better, so that we can enjoy you better. Father, we appreciate your holy name in the name of Jesus. Thank you for the journey mercies you granted everybody. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us here to hear you. Thank you for the food, the menu that you have prepared to feed us with. Father, we pray you will give us appetite. In the name of Jesus. Lord, that as the bread of life is broken before your people, you will cause them to feed freely and be satisfied. You will grant understanding. Lord, you will cause the seed of the word to bear abundance of fruit in the lives of your people in Jesus' name. Give utterance to your word, O Lord, and give unction and bless all of us together. Hide me behind the cross and cause your spirit, the great teacher, to reach out to your people this morning and through this entire day in Jesus' name. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for we have prayed in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. The theme for the program, this one-day program that we have before us, as we have been told and we have seen, is they that know their God shall be strong and they will do exploits. I'm sure you know that this is taken from the scriptures, the Holy Bible. And that is found in the book of Daniel chapter 11 verse 32. We will read it. That is the theme. Let's go there. Daniel chapter 11 verse 32. And such as do wickedly against the covenant shall it corrupt by flatteries. But the people that do know their God shall be strong and do exploits. Hallelujah. Now, this is the revelation that God gave to Prophet Daniel when he was in Babylon about the end time. He had wonderful experiences with God. We will just look at a little of these experiences later. But from what he shares here, he's sharing from these great experiences and what God revealed to him. The first part of this single verse says, they that do wickedly against the covenant shall he corrupt with flatteries. He's talking about the spirit of the Antichrist that is already in the world. And the Lord is telling us through Daniel that this spirit will corrupt many with flatteries. When he talks about, he said, they that do wickedly. Who are those that are doing wickedly? It's not just people that are killing other people. It's not just people that are stealing, that are raping, that are doing very nasty things. When the Bible talks about wickedness, it's talking about people that reject God, people that don't know God. Go through the scriptures. Says the offering of the wicked is abomination before God. The same spirit that makes people to kill, to rape, to maim, is the same spirit that works in man to disregard God. You cannot honor God. You cannot know God and kill somebody else, lie against people, do many of these nasty things we do today. So he said those who do wickedly, that is people that reject Christ, people that are outside Christ, people that trust in their own hands, in their effort. He said the Antichrist will corrupt them with flatteries. And the Bible told us that the spirit is already in the world. Our brother and sister had been talking about it, trying to make people to believe in lies. Lies. Making people to feel that they can achieve without God through self-effort, through compromise, going to juju and all sorts of things. So he said these people will continue to be deceived. They will be corrupted. But he said, but those who know their God. So the key was here, because this is where we are going. He said, those who know. So he's talking to us about knowledge of God. Those who know their God, something will happen to them. Instead of corruption by flatteries, they will be strong. And they will exploit. I've been told to handle it, you know, to divide into two, talk about God's knowledge, helping us to live victorious life, building life, and then how it affects me. But as the Spirit of the Lord helps me, it's just one, just one thing. So we look at what it means to be strong. That the benefits of knowing God is that you will be strong. We will look in this session, we will look at what it means to be strong, how we can be strong, how to do exploits through the knowledge of God. Both are applicable to your personal lives, to your families, and to the ministry. So as I continue, I want us to know what it means to know God. What does it mean to know God? You say those who know they are God. There's nobody you will talk to and will say, I don't know God. Very, very people will say that. But when the Bible is talking about knowing God, the knowledge of God, it's not talking about this one, knowing God in the head. It's not talking about knowing about God. Too many people know about God, but they don't know God. It's not even talking about knowing the word of God, because so many people have the word here. They can quote from Genesis to Revelation, but they don't know the God of the word. Let's look at Jeremiah chapter 9, verses 23 and 24, so that we can see what exactly it means to know God. Jeremiah chapter 9, verses 23 and 24. Prophet Jeremiah has this to say. Thus saith the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom, neither let the mighty man glory in his might. Let not the rich man glory in his riches, but can we read that verse together? Now, just hold it. One, two, go. But let him that glorieth glory in this, that he understandeth and knoweth me, that I am the Lord, which exercise loving kindness, judgment and righteousness in the earth. For in these things I delight, saith the Lord. That's what God has to say. Say, some of you, you are proud of your worth. Some people are proud. You say, you know, as I stand, I worth 200 billion naira. A minister of God was put on the social media and they put his worth. Then he responded, say, you that are talking that I was so and so, say, you don't know what you are talking about. He said, I have gold like dust. You don't know my worth. I worth more than you are talking about. Baba God says, let those that are glory, don't glory in your worth. That means nothing to me. Heaven doesn't rejoice when we buy new cars. Hallelujah. Is it sin to buy new cars? No. The Bible says the young lions, they suffer hunger. But those who love the Lord shall not lack anything that is good. So, good accommodation, good automobile, good things. God wants us to have them. It's not sin. Matthew 6:33 says, pursue for seek first what? And all other things, all these things you are running after, you are going to the mountains for, you are being duped for, he said, they will be added. May that continue to be your testimony in Jesus' name. So God says, look, I'm not interested in all this boasting about money that is filling the church today. Have you been to our church? 1,000 executive cars. Oh, ultra-modern cathedral. Mm-hmm. There are classes in the church today. Classes. There is where the poor can reach and where the rich belong. But is that the church that Jesus Christ built? Was there a class when Christ was here raising his disciples? He was always looking for the poor to bless. He was a friend of sinners. He taught a rich man. A rich man wanted to find out how to make the kingdom. You know what Jesus said? Go and sell everything you have and follow me. He said, this one, now, wow, I know go feed one. He went away. So, knowing God does not mean having money. Some people will say, come and see God's glory on me. You think that wealth equals the knowledge of God? Zero. You miss it. You can have all the goods in this world and may not know God. Jesus himself said, what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? It was God talking here. He said, thus hear the Lord. I'm not interested in your boasting about your positions in life. We have 500 ministers, federal ministers in our church. Oh, I'm the wife of a federal commissioner. That doesn't interest God. Or you yourself, you are occupying a big post, a manager, an MD, executive officer. God says all those things, they are ephemera. They are not priority. said, let the wise man not glory in his wisdom, that is, in your brain, your intelligence. You know how to achieve. All these things doesn't interest him. If you are going to be to boast or to glory in anything, what should you glory about? Verse 24, that you understand and know him. But there are many people that will say, I know God. I know God. Excuse me, what knowledge of God do you have? What kind of knowledge of God do you have? Many of us, we have distorted knowledge of God. We don't know him. He explained what we need to know about him. He said that I am what? Verse 24. A God that exercises loving kindness. I pray that God will reveal himself to you as a God of loving kindness. Loving kindness. He loves us unconditionally. We don't have to earn his love. Am I speaking to the understanding of anybody? Who can earn God's love? Excuse me, who deserves God's love here? Yeah, I mean, I know I deserve to be loved by God. None of us. Look at our first parents, Adam and Eve, created in God's image. They didn't deserve it. They've not done anything good. But God chose to create man to enjoy his life. He created everything to make them comfortable. Then he said, let's create man in our image. After our likeness, let them have dominion. Let them enjoy our life. He molded man, then he breathed his own breath into man, gave his spirit to man, and the man became a living soul. That's God's wonderful plan for us. Loving, kindness. This love that we produce kindness, we make you to enjoy God's goodness on end. I hope you do. I pray this morning that the Spirit of God himself will give you understanding. If we know God as a God of loving kindness, we will not think he's the one responsible for all the woes that is befalling us or the people around us or the world that we are living in. God, instead of being responsible, he's always making a way out for us. If he wanted us to suffer, he wouldn't create all those beautiful things he did before he created Adam and Eve. But you know what our first parents did now? Like my sister was saying, they wanted to become what they were already by their own effort. So they lost what they had. And it's the same thing that is happening to us today. We don't know God as a God of loving kindness. So we think he will be judging our sins. We think once we do anything wrong, we have lost favor with him. That's not your father. You don't know him. And that's why anytime we come to church, until we have confessed, even since we don't commit, we don't think we have prayed. Even when you've not committed sin. Luadari eshe mijimi. Eshe baba. Eshe koko. You know? You must confess sin before God can hear you. Excuse me, where do you find that? He said, I'm a God that is full of loving kindness. I will show you more. For you to have correct perception of God. We went for a women outreach in Niger State some years ago. So after the program, a lady called me that she wanted to see me. I invited her. So she came down to Ilorin. And she started narrating her ordeal. She said, look, I know it is my sin that is pursuing me. I want you to beg God for me. I said, what happened, my sister? She said, when I was single, I lived a very rough life. In fact, I snatched my sister's husband. I see. So, I now asked, what is now the problem? Are you born again? He said, yes, I've given my life to Christ. I've repented and the Lord has changed my life. I said, so what's your problem now? He said, the kind of dreams that I have. My business is not making progress. He said, and I went to see some men of God. They said it was the repercussion of the things I had done before. So I asked her, I said, when you came to Christ, did you repent of those things? She said, yes, I repented. I said, okay. Are you married? She said, yes. Do you have children? She said, yes. So God is really judging you. Abi, you know, since God is a judge, if God will judge her, will she be given a husband? Will she have children after destroying other people's homes? We don't know God. You will know God in the name of Jesus. God will help you to know him. I said, so you think God is judging you? And he did all this for you. So I spoke to her, canceled her, and said, look, you don't know the father that you have. It's full of loving kindness and tender mercy. And the Bible says what? God says, your sins and iniquities I will keep always before me, isn't it? I will remember no more. Hallelujah. Look, once you put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and what he did for you on the cross, he carried our sins on his body. He came purposely to rescue us from sin that is destroying us. When our first parents sinned, they brought death and everything that works death into the world and pass them to us. Out of this loving kindness, God now took initiative. We were not the one looking for him. He's the one looking for us. When Adam and Eve sinned, they were hiding. They didn't run to God to ask for forgiveness. What did they do? They hid. What did God do? God came down to look for them. That's how he came looking for all of us. I hope he has found you. Because if you have not allowed him to find you, you won't enjoy him. Look, God that is loving and kind, that's your father. If you have put your faith in Jesus Christ, he's forgiven your sins. So don't think whatever is happening negatively to you comes from him. No. He's the solution. He is the answer. He gave us the answer by sending Jesus. Hallelujah. So, loving kindness. He said, I want you to know me as a God that executes loving kindness, not as a God that destroys. But if anything happens today, accident happens, they say, na God, kosam. You are sick, they say, God wants to draw you to himself. How many parents will want to do that? You want to afflict your child so that he can come back. Look at how we pursue our children now. They don't do what is good, we still go after them. Say, home. Look at how mothers yearn after their children. Even children that... Now, the second thing he talks about him, he said, the way God introduces himself here is, again, is what? Say, and executed judgment. You got to know God as a God that executes judgment. Execute judgment against you. Put your hands together for Jesus. I'm happy that you are knowing him. Execute judgment against who? Against the devil. That's where Jesus came. He came to judge the devil on your behalf. That's where the Lord Jesus, when he was going away, he told us that the Holy Spirit he will send to us. And when the Holy Spirit comes, what will he do? He will convict the world of sin, of judgment, and of righteousness. Of sin because what? Because they don't know me. The greatest thing you can commit that will land you in hell is to reject Jesus as your Savior and Lord. Not adultery. Not murder. Not embezzlement. That's the only sin that will take you to hell is that you reject the Savior. The one that came to deliver you from sin and the consequences of sin, which is death. Death here and death in eternity. That is separate, eternal separation from God. So, God sent Jesus to execute judgment on the devil on your behalf so that Satan will lose his power over you and myself. That's what Christ went to do on the cross. You remember that immediately Adam and Eve sinned and God came down. They didn't even apologize. So did they apologize? What were they doing? They were excusing their sin and putting the blame on God. Adam, why did you do this? Say, she be not the woman where you give me now. Is the woman you gave me. Eve, how is it? Is the serpent you created? And that's what we do today. Even today, we excuse our sins and put it back on God. Hey, Lord, why did you give me this kind of man to marry? Is the one responsible for all my problems? Why did you do this? Why did you do that? But what did God do? God came down. Even though they didn't repent, he still made provision. He killed an animal, shed his blood as a type of Christ who will come to redeem, to shed his blood for eternity, for all mankind. Then he took the skin of the animal, made it a cloth, a coat, and covered them. Not only that, he now gave a promise. He said, I'm going to create enmity between you and the woman, and the seed of the woman, the serpent. Between you and the serpent. So, this serpent will bruise your heel, that is the heel of your generations. But a seed is coming from a woman that will do what? Crush his head. That's what Christ came to do on the cross. That's where Satan lost his power. If you don't put your faith in what Christ has done on the cross, you can be going all over the place praying serious prayers, dangerous prayers. You will never know victory. That's a fact. It was when Christ went to the cross, he crushed the head of the serpent. And when he came out of the grave, he exhibited power and authority. He defeated them. And you know what he said in Matthew 28:18? All power is now given to me in heaven and on earth. The power that Adam and Eve gave to the serpent when they sinned, they lost their authority. Christ now came to take it back and give to us. So all power, that's why he said to the disciple, go ye therefore. I'm releasing that power unto you so that you can go and do exploits. So, Christ came to judge the devil for you, not to judge you. So, what's the purpose of God coming if you are to be judged? Where this thing is God's judgment against me. You remember when Christ was here in John chapter 9? They were going and they saw a man that was born blind. And the disciples said, Master, who sin is responsible for this man that is born blind? Is it his sin or the sin of his parents? Is that not the question we ask today when problem comes into our lives? Say, Oluwa, Abi, na which sin I commit, oh God, please search me, oh God. I know my heart today. You begin to search unsearchables. Abi, what did I do? Then you go to your foundation. If it's not you, me, then it must be my parents or my foreparents. Eh? You say, it's generational curse. Oh my God. How are you reading your Bible? What does Galatians chapter 3, verse 13 say? Christ has done what? Redeemed us from the curse of the law. Every curse that came into this world was as a result of sin. Jesus came to redeem us from them all. And the Bible says, so that the blessings of Abraham can come upon us that are Gentiles. So, curses have been judged. Satan has been judged. Sin has been judged on the cross by Christ. But if you don't know it, you are not conscious of it. If you have not put your faith in that great work that Jesus did on the cross, in his resurrection from the dead, you will not be able to enjoy it. You will be seeing yourself as judged. So what did Jesus answer them? He said, it's not because of his sin, nor because of his parents' sin, but no, that I might be glorified. That is, I came as an answer. I don't come to judge. And do you know what? We don't only judge ourselves. So even though Christians, you judge people. When something not good happens, they say, we think she's a spiritual person. No? She must be doing some things underground. If not be so, this thing cannot happen to him. You know the same thing the friends of Job did. You remember? They say it's your sin. You are acting good. You are acting righteous. If you are not a sinner, God will not allow this to happen to you. Misrepresentation of God. You don't know God when you think like that. God, who knows that you don't have power to stand against sin, how can he judge you for sinning? He only judge you because you reject Jesus. He gave you the solution, the answer. You put your faith in Christ. He comes into you. He transforms you. Break the power of sin. Give you the grace to begin to live victorious life. So why should he now? You know, but if you reject that, you will continue to sin. And you will land where you don't want to. So the real gospel is not like we used to preach it. Brother Adroja said, I've been there before. We've all been there before. Repent or perish. Repent or perish. Repent or perish. Only Jesus can save. It's true now, isn't it? But the message is, repent for the kingdom of God is at hand. Jesus, today, Jesus has come to deliver from you from the power of sin. Repent means turn your mind. You know, change your mindset of trying to work for salvation. Look at that beautiful, those beautiful songs we sang. The first one, Rock of Ages, cleft for me. He said, nothing in my hands I bring, simply to the cross I cling. Naked come to thee for dress, helpless look to thee for grace. Foul I to the fountain flood, wash me, Savior, I die. Nothing in my hands I bring. Then he went on, he said, not the labors of my hands can fulfill thy lost demand. Could my zeal no respite know? Till my tears forever flow, all for sin could not atone. Thou must save, and thou there's nothing you can do to earn God's salvation. Your weeping cannot save you. You know, some people believe you must suffer yourself, weep, cry. They are looking for salvation for 5 years. They have not found. Where did you get that in the Bible? The one that is already waiting, he's waiting for you. You are begging. Only to put, believe, receive me. He said, he came unto his own. His own did what? But those who received him, just to receive him, receive what he did for you. You don't have to add anything to it. So he came to judge not you. He came to judge the devil. He came to judge your sin so that it will not have power over you anymore. Have you put your faith in him? That's the only way. No matter how much you struggle with it, you will never overcome. Because this man, this body, this flesh, this Adam, is already sold, is in bondage to sin. Go to mountains. I was counseling a young man some time ago. The the aunt brought him to me. They said, this boy, that look, there's nothing we have not done. Fasted, taking him to mountains, washed, drank anointing oil, everything. Say he never changed. Ronnie, no, he will not stay at home. He will not go to school. He will steal. He will be doing this and that. That they have been to so many places. But now they went somewhere. And the man of God said, go to find out about his foundation. Where is the mother? Where is the father? The father has died. So, okay, go find out. The mother did something. So, the mother said, when they went to the mother, mother had remarried. Mother now said, I only remember that when I was pregnant, I used to see men of God, priests, passing. I say, oh God, if you give me a man child, a man, a boy, I'm going to give him to you to serve you. They say, hey! Covenant. Because you did fulfill the covenant, this boy is supposed to be a preacher. You are sending him to school. He will not know book. I say, so they said they should go and they should take him to theological school so that he could become a pastor. So they went to some theological schools. To the glory of God, we were planning for a ladies' conference in Ilorin, interdenominational like this one. So somebody gave this woman a flyer of the program. So when she saw the flyer, she said, Mrs. Kokwala. She now remembered she could come to discuss. She came, she was crying. She was weeping bitterly. I said, Mommy, kuletunye. There's no problem. I said, there's nothing we have not done. He will steal. If he lives here for 3 months, he will steal. They will drive him away. Everything he was doing, they told me. I said, okay, don't worry, Mom. Please, just send him to me. He said, no, I came to you so that you can help us to adopt him. So that he will be staying with you. They say he should become mission boy. So that you will be training him to become a pastor. I laughed. I said, don't worry, just send him to me. So when they sent this boy, so I sent for one of our brothers who live in the same area to bring him. That one is an engineer. So I greeted and said, my brother, how are you? He said, fine. I said, so what's the problem? Narrated his ordeal. So I said, my brother, You are not suffering from any covenant, covenant cause. You say, Mommy, I've done everything. I've suffered, fasted, sleep on Monday. I say, don't worry. You know your problem. You don't know God. They've done deliverance upon deliverance. I said, and now turn to the brother who brought him. I said, engineer, say you didn't steal when you were a teenager. Your mind didn't go after women. I started talking about sins all of us do commit. Who among you is not a sinner? Yeah, let me see your hand up. You never sinned since you were born. Holy run. Me, you brought him to. When I was small, me too, I sin now. I used to steal my mother's meat. I can cut part of it so that they will not know. When they can, they will still see that the same it's the same number. Some of you are resolving with me now. You've been doing it before. Put your hands together for Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I say, my brother, just come off it. What they are complaining about, all of us are guilty. Everybody passes through it. He was looking at me. You know there's a Yoruba adage. You know what he says? He said, Agba. Oh yeah. Burabe we oshiori. You are now grown up. You have found favor with God. You are now living victorious life. And your children now, you are putting accusing finger. You are cursing them. Oh, Lori Buruku, ma Buruku, Adile Waje. You, Nko, when you were like him, didn't you do worse things? You curse your children because they are doing what you also did before. Only God helped you now. It's the loving kindness of God that brought you out, that didn't reckon these things against you. I said, my brother, do you want to receive Jesus Christ as Savior? He's the one that can save you. If you receive him right now, your life will be transformed. I shared with him the story of our own children, pastor's children, but they had their own challenges when they got to the teenage. Oh my, some of my brethren here from NTCM, they know Dr. Femi Popoola. His testimony is great. I won't waste your time, because if we go into that, it will take me another 30 minutes. But when he again encountered the Lord, after, you know, they knew the Lord as kids, because they were brought up in the world. At teenage, they went to exploit the world, But by the time the Lord re-encountered them, if you know what God is using him to do today, all of them, all our children, it's wonderful. So I said, oh boy, you see, serving God, you will serve God. All of us are called to serve God. Abi, why are you here? Why are you made in God's image? So that you can represent him now, here. So are you ready to give your life to Jesus? He said, yes, ma. All I have done before didn't help. We prayed, he gave his life to Christ. I said, so let him just stay around for maybe 4 weeks and, you know, go to some discipleship work, you know, come to church, listen to the word, see how he can grow spiritually and continue. By the end of the 4 weeks, he was so transformed that the mother didn't know what, the aunt didn't know what to do with him. He ran away from school. He was to do his final exam. He left school. He went back, finished, completed, and passed. No anointing oil. We didn't call fire down. We didn't go to the root. We didn't talk about the covenant. We just presented Jesus and him crucified. That's where the answer is to any problem you have in life. It's not going to sleep with these dirty men, you know, that call themselves pastors. You bring problem, they add to it. That boy so transformed. By the time he finished, he came and said, Mommy, please, I want to begin to learn something before my result comes out. So we arranged that he should go to learn what do you call it now? Technical something. He's doing beautifully well now. Serving God in his church. And no more struggle, no more no fighting sin, no more all those yama yama. If you are here this morning and you are facing the same challenge, you've tried your best, you've not been able to overcome, just turn to Jesus. Say, Lord, I know you've done it all for me. I receive what you did on the cross. I put my faith in the finished work. Come and be my Savior and Lord. You will never be the same again in Jesus' name. The reason we are still swimming in the river, you sleep and people are messing you up in your sleep, is because you have not really known him who judged the devil on your behalf. That the devil has been judged. Your sin has been judged. How can you be a child of this wonderful, loving, kind father that is loving and kind, and one nasty, dirty thing will be coming to sleep with you? You are united with Jesus now. You are married to Jesus. You are born again. You are married to Jesus. So, in the last part of it, he said that I come to not only execute loving kindness and judgment, but righteousness on the earth. I have come to take away your sin and give you my righteousness. I have come to take away your filthy garments of self-righteousness. Know, some of us, we labor, we struggle to please God. We fast. We have this loss. Lord, please help me to take it away. Some of us, some of our children, we're taking them for marks, incisions, buried. They didn't change. They can't change. You can't change yourself. Jesus is the one that brought God's righteousness to us. He's our righteousness. Isaiah 64 verses says, all our own righteousness is like what? Filthy rags before him. So he wants us to receive his own righteousness. And you receive it by faith. When you give your life to Christ, he put his righteousness to your account. He blots away your sin. It's as if you've never sinned before. Then he comes to dwell in you. And as you continue to walk with him, remembering that you are no longer in Adam, that you are in Christ, Christ in you, then you discover that righteousness begin to prevail. Holiness of life continues to work on you. People begin to see you and say, please, what happened to you? Mama, so so and so. You are so changed. That will be your story in Jesus. So that's what it means to know God. Do say, those who know their God, they will be strong and do exploit. Do you know you can be in the church and not know God? You can be serving God and not know God. Do you know the disciples, they walked with Jesus for 3.5 years and they didn't know him? In John chapter 14, when he was giving them the bye-bye message, even after he had said everything, Thomas said, we don't know you. We don't know where you are going. He said, you mean you don't know me? He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Then Philip said, show us the Father then. Jesus said, Philip, have you been so long time with me and yet you don't know me? Don't you know that I am the Father and the Father is in me? The best representation of God is who? Christ. Is the only one that came to show us who God is. All that people are telling us about God is not correct to most people unless they refer you to Jesus. So whatever they tell you God is doing that Jesus didn't do is a lie. Yeah. God is not the one doing it. John 1:18. Jesus said, nobody has seen the Father, which means nobody knows God before he came. That's big, but if I want to decode everything, we won't live here. Say, but the only begotten Son of the Father that has been with him, that comes from his bosom, is the one that knows him. I have come to represent him, to show him who God is. I want to show you. That's why I came. So when Jesus was here, was he killing anybody? Killing the enemy? Commanded them to fall down and die? What did he do? Acts 10:38. What did the Bible tell us Jesus did? He went about doing, hallelujah, he's always doing good. He said, and God anointed Jesus of Nazareth. He went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of devils, for God was with him. So, can you see God in Christ? So, if God wanted to kill us, if he's the one responsible for all these things that is happening to us, why did he send Jesus, anoint him, and was walking with him to heal, to deliver? You say, it's because we have done one thing or another. God is visiting our iniquity. It is not so. That is misrepresentation of God. May you begin to know God correctly in Jesus' name. So you can be in the church and not know God, though. Disciples walk with him 3.5 years, and yet they didn't know him. He was telling them, I came to die for you. I will die. You will die. Okay. I said, don't talk about it. Even when he died, they still did not understand. You remember he was going with two of his disciples on the way to Emmaus. And he walked with them. They were going and said, they were talking about Jesus. They didn't know Jesus was the one standing. He said, what are you talking about? He said, who are you? Are you a stranger in Israel? And you don't understand what happened of this day. Don't you hear about one Jesus Christ? And he said, oh, you fools and slow to understand all that the scriptures has written about Christ. Should Christ not come, suffer, resurrect, and be glorified so that you can be delivered? They didn't know him. I pray you will know him. We can be born by spiritual parents and not know God. But you will know him in Jesus' name. And do you know the knowledge of God is not just a one-day affair? It's not a one-time affair. It is a progressive affair. You continue to know. He said, then shall we know if we continue to know the Lord. So you know him at the start. Then you continue to walk with him and he continues to manifest himself unto you. You remember Paul, Apostle Paul, Abby? Do we remember Apostle Paul? When Jesus was here, did he know him? He knew him physically, but he didn't have experiential knowledge of Christ. He didn't believe him that he was the Savior. So what was he doing? He was persecuting the believers. And yet he was a religious leader. He was teaching the law. And he was killing Christians. Do you know that's what happens when people don't have correct knowledge of God? When you don't know Christ as Savior and Lord, you'll be criticizing other believers. You'll be persecuting them. In your working place, you'll be persecuting them. Yeah, Timothy, you're too much. She carry me. They are hypocrites. Because you yourself have not experienced Christ, even though you bear Christian names. So what kind of knowledge do you have of God? But one glorious day, Christ encountered Paul on the way to Damascus. He was never the same again. Hallelujah. May you have the same encounter in Jesus' name. So much that after immediately he said, look, what do you want me to do? He was ready now to do the will of God. anything God would want him to do. The one who was persecuting the Christian and killing them, he was looking for them to fellowship with. So that's how you know somebody who has truly known God. You will be looking for people who know God to fellowship with. So that is what it means to know God. To know him as the Father of mercy and grace. Not a father of judgment. Not a wicked father. If you just, I pray God will give you understanding. If you live through the Bible, you will know that the way we present God is wrong. You go read again Luke chapter 15. Jesus himself gave three parables. The lost sheep, the lost coin, and the lost son. The lost sheep, was it the sheep looking for the shepherd? And that is God. He was talking to you about God. He said, that's how, when a sinner repents, God is happy in heaven. Because when the shepherds found the sheep, he was rejoicing. The lost coin, was he looking for the owner? No. Eh? The lost coin. What brought the prodigal son home? Eh? Somebody who had collected every belonging, everything that belongs to him. In the father's eye, father was still alive. He said, I beg, I can't wait till you die. Make you give me everything that belongs to me. We wait, you know that. So let me have my own portion. If you die later, that's all right. Hallelujah. But then, when he now went into the world and saw the other side of the world, he saw fire. He saw what the devil can do with a man who refused to stay in the father's house, who refused to acknowledge the father's law. Then he said, ha, even no food anymore. They said he had to be feeding swine. Even he wanted to eat the food that they were giving to pigs, nobody gave him. But when he remembered the father's law, he said, ha, but the home I came from, my father even loves the servants and treats them well. I think if I can enjoy just that love for the servant, I will be good. I'm going back home. It was the father's love that drew him. It was not that he repented, he was sorry for what he did. So that's your father. He loves you even when you are sinning. He says, son, come home, daughter. Come. You know, your sin is destroying you. When the Bible say, people say God is angry, and the Bible says God is angry with the wicked every day. He's angry because you are killing yourself. He's angry. We are mothers, some of us. When your child is doing something that will kill him, will you be happy? That's what the Bible is saying. God is angry with the wicked that he's destroying himself. It's not that he's angry, he wants to kill the wicked. So, do we know God? Do we want to know him? That's what it means to know God. Then I will just share with us before we close on the benefits of knowing God. You know, he told us two things. The first one I will handle now is, he said, those who know their God will be strong. When you know God as your father, loving kindness, full of loving kindness and mercy, when you get home, go and read Psalm 103. It's wonderful. Describing this wonderful Father. Forgives all our sins. Puts away our iniquity from us. Heals our diseases. And delivers us from oppressions. Then he went on. He said, he's full of mercy. See, he's full of mercy. Gracious. He does not always chide. God doesn't always pick fault with you, complain about you. Excuse me, look at as we are here now. Are there not things wrong with us? You yourself, you know. Yeah, God, I wish I can overcome this. But God, you will pray, we hear you. He doesn't count your sin against you He's saying, look, my son has taken your sins upon himself. He nailed it to the cross. So he said, God does not always chide like we do. They're always complaining about each other. Abby, complain about your husband. So he doesn't do anything good. Even if he did 50 things wrong and 50 good, you don't see 50 that is good. If he did 70 right, is the 30% you will sit upon and say, I have never enjoyed anything since I came to this house. You've always been wicked to me. I don't know why I married you. God doesn't deal with us like that. He doesn't always chide. He doesn't visit our iniquity against ourselves. I was counseling a couple one day. I was tired. I was fed up. I think say now women they talk. I don't know say men too they talk. I said to, please, and what happened? When the husband started, the next 1 hour he was talking. I didn't know this. Is this the kind of, how do you say that in unfortunate, wicked, nasty woman I married. Talk. When the woman came, you can be sure, if man can speak like that for one, for the next 2 hours, the woman was talking. I regret marrying him. They now told me stories to, the Lord will show us mercy. If God is dealing with us the way we are dealing with each other, how many of us will be alive today? I just want to scintillate you a little. To know the Father, your Father, the God that you say you are serving, so that you can enjoy him more. Because everything that should stand between you and him, he took to the cross by his son, he nailed to the cross. Look at Psalm 103 verse from verse 8. It says, the Lord is merciful and gracious. You know what mercy means? He doesn't give you the bad things that you deserve. You can commit abortion 50 times. You marry, he still gives you children. And then some people will say, me that I never saw a man before I married. This one that wasted her life. She married, she's having children. God, you are wicked. No, he's not wicked. He treats everybody equally. He's merciful to all. You didn't commit immorality. Were you not a liar? Yes. All of us are sins. See, we were sinners. James 2:10 and 11 said, if you keep the old law and you offend in one point, you are what? Guilty of every other sin. No sin is greater than the other before God. So stop pointing accusing finger. That's why we don't receive answer from God for our prayers. We think we deserve it. God, you are unjust. It's not God who closed your own womb. We told you about misrepresentation of God. It's plenty in the Bible. The Old Testament prophets, they didn't know God. I can't explain that in details. They have a wrong perception of God. Since Eden, since Adam and Eve fell, people always accuse God of being the one responsible for the things they are the ones that caused. Do you understand that now? So the same mentality the prophets of old had. Is it God closed the womb of Hannah? Did you see that when Jesus came? That Jesus was closing wombs? But the mentality of the fall of Adam, of the world, did not say anything that is bad, God is the cause. It's not to, please, if you don't get it right, you will never enjoy him. When you know he's not responsible, then you'll be able to face your enemy and see him defeated. And you will see victory in your life in Jesus' name. So, mercy is that it doesn't give you the bad things you deserve. Grace is that even the good things you don't deserve, it begins to pour it into your life. May that be your experience continually in Jesus' name. Verse 9 says, he will not always chide. neither will he keep his anger forever. You know what? When law meant people with law mindset, mentality, they will interpret that and say, you better stop what you are doing. God will not hold his anger forever. A time will come, we get angry, and that's not what the Bible is saying. Go and read other translations. Go and read the Greek and Hebrew lexicon. You will see it means that God does not continue to be angry. It doesn't mean that I've been patient enough with you, so now my anger. That's not God. He's always been a loving God, a gracious God. You will see more of his grace upon your life in Jesus' name. So, he said, he doesn't keep his anger for him. He has not dealt with us after our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. That's your father now. Eh? For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is his mercy to them that fear him. Well, for time, let me stop with verse 12. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. Verse 13, like a father pities his children, so the Lord pitied him that fear him. He knows our frame. He's always concerned about us. He's compassionate about us. He wants it to be well with you. That's why he sent Jesus. But you got to put your faith in him. So when you now know him properly, he said, you will be strong. You'll be strong spiritually. You'll be strong physically. You'll be strong emotionally. Mentally, you will be strong. Strong spiritually. It means you will have spiritual stamina to stand temptations. There are many Christians that they fall in time of temptation. And the Bible says, if you fall in the day of trouble, what happens? Your strength is small. So which means you don't know God enough. So, there are temptations in our working places. Abi, some of us are secretaries to bosses who will want to sleep with you. Some of us, the friends of our husband will want to sleep with you. Some, your lecturers, your teachers, even people you are serving God together in the church. We've seen that a lot. In the choir, they'll be sleeping with each other. Just like you find in 1 Samuel chapter 2. Ophni and Phineas, they were Lehi's children, priest's children, they were messing up the women in the church. How would you be able to stand temptation if you don't know this wonderful God who has been to the cross, who carried your sin to the cross, who died your death, who resurrected to give you new life? He came from the grave to give you resurrection life. Victorious life. So, Jesus overcame temptation. You know he was tempted too, Abby. There's nobody that will not be tempted though. You'll be tempted to buy certificates, to forge certificates, to sleep with men, to get contract. You'll be tempted to do many nasty things. But if you know who you are, if you know who is your father, you know he's bigger than all these things. Abi? Jesus, how did he overcome? The Bible said he was always conscious of who he was. He knew who he was. He knew he was the Son of God. The Father told him that before he went to the wilderness to be tempted. And he was conscious of that. So he was always referring the enemy to the word. You know he's the word. I will not go through his temptation because I don't have more time left. So, temptations are banned. It is when you know who you are in Christ. Because when you know God, you know the true God, then you will know yourself. 2 Corinthians 3:18 says, "And we all, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, is being transformed." We are being changed into the same image from glory to glory. As you see Christ victorious, was there any sin in him? The Bible said he never sinned. In him is no sin. He was the harmless and blameless Son of God. So if you now see yourself in him, having taken your sin, you remember what Paul says in Galatians 2:20? He said, "I'm crucified with, nevertheless I, yet not I." Hallelujah. When you really know God, when you have given your life to him, you have started out to know him by taking him as your Savior and Lord, you will remember that it's no longer your life. When you are a child of God, it's not your life you are living. So, leave God to live his life out through you. Stop struggling to please God. Stop struggling to live for him. You can't live for him. He's the one that can live the righteous life through you. So you can only overcome temptation when you know the Lord. You remember Joseph in Genesis chapter 39? Abby, look at that terrible temptation. The wife of the boss wanted him to sleep with her. But what happened? Did he struggle? Say, "Oh God, please, don't let, Lord, please, take away this loss." He said, "Madam, it's not possible. How can I do this terrible thing, this wickedness, and sin against God?" He had relationship with God. So even when the woman wanted to rape him, he ran away. But today we will give excuse. "But he's stronger than me. He overpowered me. There was nobody to rescue me. He locked me up in the office." Joseph refused to be locked up because he knew God. Because he knew God, he knew himself in God. I pray you begin to know who you are in Christ in Jesus' name. So when you know God, you will be strong to stand against temptations. Not to temptation, for yielding is sin. Hallelujah. When you know God, another benefit is that you will be strong in faith. You'll be able to depend on God for your need. You will not be using your effort to fend for yourself. Daniel chapter 1. If you read the book of Daniel chapter 1, you will discover that when Daniel was one of the captives of Israel taken to Babylon, when they got there, the king wanted to choose people that we begin to advise him in the kingdom, we'll be seen into the realm of the, you know, the unseen, necromancers, astrologers, and so on. Then they said they should look into the midst of the Israelites too and pick noble children so that they would train them. They would go to the school of science, horoscope, and all that. Daniel was among them. Then they ordered that they should give them special food, the king's food, so that they will begin to look great. Then their brain also will be sharp to catch what they are teaching them. They sent them to the University of Babylon. Then they said, "Sir, please, I can't take this menu, the king's menu. Please, let me feed on pulse and water." What does that signify? Daniel refused to feed on junks, spiritual junks. He knew who he was. He knew he was Omoba. He was a prince. He was a representative of God in Babylon. He wouldn't join the people to do what they were doing. So he refused to allow worldly principles to run his life. They think that food is the one that will help them to be sharp and look fine. Then what they are trying to pass into their head will be able to enter. He said, no, I will not use human effort. I will not feed on junks. I will depend on my God. That's why you could say, those who know their God, they shall be strong and do exploits. Ah, the man in charge said, hey, if the king see you after, is it 30, 40 days, he said, hey, and you look, he said, look, forget about it. We won't look worse. Because he took decision, three other friends joined him. I pray God will use you to influence others for Christ in Jesus' name. He said, I will not feed on the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. I want to feed on the tree of life. I don't want to follow the example of Adam and Eve. I want to feed on Jesus. I want to feed on the finished work. It is sufficient for me. It will nourish me physically. It will also nourish. Do you know at the end of how many days did they call it? Eh? Do you know after? Yes, they tried them for 10 days, but later the king brought them to see him after so many days. Do you know what happened? By the time the king canceled them, discussed with them, they say he found Daniel and his friends 10 times better. Wow. Put your hands together for Jesus Christ. That's Daniel chapter 1, verse 19. Okay, 18. At the end of the days, they didn't put us the days. The king had said he should bring them in. Then the prince of the eunuch brought them in before Nebuchadnezzar. And the king communed with them. And among them all was found none like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore stood they before the king. And in all matters of wisdom and understanding, hallelujah, God will do that in your life. That you will surpass your colleagues, even professionally. They had special wisdom and understanding. The king inquired of them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers that were in the realm. Hallelujah. When you know the Lord, you will be so strong in your determination to trust Christ only, Jesus only, for every need in your life, for wisdom, for professional ability, proficiency, and you will see that God will make you to be better than your colleagues, even than your superiors. But when you begin to use your own effort, fasting, adoani, if we see or some major to be genuine, na lie. Maybe you've done that so many times. What did you get? It is Jesus. It is Lord. We talk to you from experience. They were strong physically. They were better to look at. When you begin to put your faith in Christ, the finished work, Christ crucified, Christ resurrected, you see, you begin to enjoy better health. I'm telling you, when you know the Lord, I'm a living testimony. I used to be very sickly before I knew the Lord as Savior and Lord. Even though I was religious, I was secretary of this Christian organization. But when I met Christ personally, everything changed. That time I used to be very sick. That time I used to have nightmare. When it's getting to things like this, fear will grip me. Say, Modana iletunshu. Hey, these people, they come again tonight. I did for trouble. But once I gave my life to Christ and I knew God properly, that He's my Father, that Jesus died my death, He paid for my sins, I'm now free, I'm a child of God. They don't feel come again. Now I sleep like a baby. all the sicknesses disappeared. And I've continued to enjoy divine healing, divine aid. I will not take your time. God delivered me from asthma. Have you ever seen that? It's not possible. Asthma. I inherited it. But I put my faith in God in the year 1984. Since then, the Lord took it away. 2019, I was to be operated upon. I had stones in my gallbladder. Big stones. It was giving me terrible pains. I was suffering. The children said, "Mommy, please, let them take this thing out so that you can have peace." I said, "God, please now. You can do this thing yourself. You are my God. You are the greatest surgeon." And I said, "Daddy, please agree with me." We prayed. I'm telling you, a day to the time to do the operation. They sent me to go and do the investigations to show whether my heart and other system are fit to do the operation, because it's a major operation. I just got there and the Holy Spirit said, "Ask them to do another ultrasound." I said, "Ultrasound? They've done it. I did CT scan and they saw the stones. They said at least 7. I said, "He said, tell them to do another ultrasound." Now, so I do more. They couldn't find a single stone anymore. Hallelujah. Shada is the God you say is the one responsible for all our troubles. It's not. It's the fall that is causing us the trouble. The sin we inherited from our parents. The world fell. Man fell. Death started reigning since our first parents sinned. But Jesus is the answer. So when you learn to click on the cross, you just allow your faith to go to say, "My Papa." May you begin to enjoy Him more than ever in your life in Jesus' name. So, faith in Him, that's it. You must learn to put your faith in Christ. When you really know God, your faith in the Lord will be strong. When you are facing persecutions, temptations, and trials, you will not begin to go to mountains and hills, because you know, "Oh, I know whom I have believed, and I'm persuaded that He is able to do that which I committed unto Him against that day." When you know Him whom you have believed, you will look at the devil and say, "Look, even if you kill me, I no go compromise." You will be like the 3 Hebrew children. Say, "Oh yeah, throw us into the fire. We will not worship your image." If our God, we know our God can deliver us. If He doesn't deliver us, fine. Did He deliver them or not? He will deliver you. Let's look. Knowledge of God makes our faith to stand strong in time of trials and tribulations. May you increase in the knowledge of God in Jesus' name. Before they got there, Jesus was already there. In the fire. They just got in there. The fire just loosed their bones. And they were walking and praising God inside the fire with Jesus Christ. They can say, "What am I saying? Son of God, me." They do forget what He says. He says Isaiah 43 or 42. "Say, when you pass through the fire, I will be with you through the flood, the rivers. They will not overcome you." That will become your testimony in Jesus' name. So when you really know God, you will be strong. Whatever the devil brings against you. Unemployment. Delay in getting a life partner. You not go and say, "Just anybody, anyhow. Just anybody, anybody." You will not even pray about it. And then you fall into the hand of 419. Drug addict. They begin to beat you like goats. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name. You'll be able to stand if there is delay in having children, because you know the Lord. Because you know who you are in Christ. You know the things of this life are temporal. That even if you don't have children here, it does not take your place in heaven. Hey, Joe, will they count the number of children when we get to heaven? Even if you still remain barren, why don't you raise children for God here? What God is interested in is in raising children for Him. That is, children that will look like Him, that will manifest the life of God. They are your crown in heaven. Do you know there are many that raise biological children and they are not looking after them today? They don't even want to see them. After they've taken care of them, they will not say they are witch. Isn't that your mama they do you? It's the one that didn't allow you to get husband. It's the one that is not allowing you to get children. But when you know your God, whatever the devil brings against you, you will stand firm in faith that the Lord your God is for you. He loves you. He loves you. He cares for you. When you know Him, you will not allow fear and worries. You know, there are too many things that can make us to be afraid, especially in this country now. Hey, Boko Haram, they have reached Lagos, so they loaded 50 buses. They say, hey, you're afraid of everybody you see. They say, don't eat watermelon, no, because the Hausas have injected poison inside. Too many things to make you anxious, to make you fear. But when you know your God, what happens? Fear. You will be strong in faith, not in fear. So for God has not given you the spirit of fear, but of love, of power, and of a sound mind. Hallelujah. It is the knowledge of God, the true knowledge of God, that this loving and kind God is looking after me. Said, cast all your cares on Him. Why? Because He cares for you. He cares. But we carry the care upon our head and it's too heavy for us. That's why we fall prey to all this nonsense that is happening around. Don't carry your cares. Don't carry your worries. Worrying about your children, give it to Jesus. He loves you. He loves the children. He loves them more than you said. So when you really know God, you know God correctly, your faith will be strong to stand trials, to stand persecutions, to stand tribulations. How did God go through, did Jesus Christ go through the cross? Because He knew who He was. He knew His Father was full of loving kindness and mercy and judgment and righteousness. That's why He could not be praying against the enemy when they were killing Him. He was rather saying, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. Because He knew His Father, that the Lord will justify Him by raising Him up the third day. He knew God loves them. God doesn't want them to be destroyed. But today, because we don't know God, we want our enemies to be destroyed. Abi? Say, God, kill them. But Jesus didn't pray that His enemies be killed. And He told us specifically, He said, love your enemy. Pray for them that persecute you. When you do, that's when God will fight for you. God will make way for you. Said, when a man's ways pleases the Lord, what does he do? He makes his enemy to be at peace with him. Why are you trying to do it yourself? If you are doing this yourself, they will never be at peace with you. They will increase their mercandise against you. So, knowledge of God makes you strong to stand against fear, against worries, against anxiety. School fees, my children's school fees, these are, it will go. Not only that, when you truly know God, the life of righteousness, the life of holiness will not be by your effort. If you look at, you go and read it when you get home, because I don't want to take more of your time. Daniel chapter 6, verses 1 to 4. Do you know, because Daniel knew God, the Bible told us that the others who were working with him as leaders, they wanted to implicate him so that the king would dismiss him. But what happened? They could not find a single fault in him. Hallelujah. That's not by self-effort. The life of God in him made him to be blameless. In your working place, sister, can they say that about you? When people gang up, say, let's catch her. Will they not be able to find things against you? They cannot find any fault in the neighborhood, in the home. That is what knowing God can do for us. It makes us to be strong against trials, against tribulations, against error. Against, you'll be able to detect error and run away from it. You will not feed on junks. Even if they say that is the only place where your problem can be solved, you say, I better die in my problem than to go and feed on junks, to allow demons to minister to me. And they are not helping you. They are only adding to your problem. So the knowledge of God will help you to bear fruit, the fruit of the Spirit. The more you know God, the more you become like him. Did you really remember? God is loving, he's kind, he's merciful, he's gracious, he's patient. If you read the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 to 24, you see all these things there. That's the nature of God, of our Baba. It begins to manifest in you when you know him. That is when you give your life to him, when you have encounter, and you continue to walk with him, identifying with your true nature, which is Christ in you. So Jesus in us is the hope of glory. That's how we can live holy life. It's not by our effort. Esther was not the only one in Babylon, but because the grace of God was working with her, she became the queen. So what is it? Where do you need strength? Jesus, faith in what Jesus has done will give it to you. That's the knowledge you have. Look, you cannot know God if you don't know Jesus. That's what we saw. Is knowing Jesus that means knowing God? Some people claim they know God. They reject Jesus. You are lying. So, Jesus produces holiness in us. If not only will you not be able to sin, but you will be gentle. You will be kind to others. You'll be able to suffer long with your husband and not give up. Long suffering. With your parents, with people in your working place, you will have joy in time of trouble. These are the fruit of the Spirit. That's what it means to be strong. When you know God, you will have joy when things are falling apart all around you. You will be meek and lowly like Jesus. Eh? When people correct you, you won't get angry and avoid them. You are easily corrected, easy to be entreated. When people offend you, even before they say they are sorry, you forgive them. You don't even record it against them. And when you offend people, it's very easy for you to say, oh, I'm really sorry. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. Because the life of Christ is manifesting in you. You know God. That's the knowledge of God. You remember when Jesus Christ was going away in John chapter 17 and he was praying for his disciples. He said, and this is life eternal. That's verse 3. That they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. So when Jesus says you will receive eternal life when you believe, that's John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him will not perish but have eternal life. What he's talking about is that you will know God. When you know God, you have eternal life. So when that life is in you, it will produce fruit of righteousness. It will make you to love your enemy. You will not pack out of your husband's house, no matter how difficult it is, unless he wants to kill you. If you say, I go kill you, if you don't go, you will say, at least so that you will not become a murderer through me. But you will not, because he's misbehaving, say, oh, enough of this. This marriage is finished. You will have self-control over your appetite, self-control over your lust, over sleep, over the way you spend money. You will also be faithful in whatever you do. I don't know what the Lord is talking to you about this afternoon. Do you really know him? Do you want to know him? Paul encountered Jesus on the way to Damascus. But even in Philippians chapter 3, you know what he said? Verse 10, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. He's still praying that he should know God. That's why our sister said, pray that we know him. Don't say, me, I'm born again now. That's the starting point. You got to continue to know him. And how do you continue to know him? Keep on looking for him in the scriptures. When you are reading the Bible, don't read it to find what you can use to pray against the enemy. Don't read it to find something, hey, I want to claim this promise. What are you claiming that Jesus has not already paid for? Faith. Just find Christ inside there. Say, search the scriptures. You need to think you have life. They are they that testify of me. From Genesis to Revelation, everything is about Jesus. So make time to read the word. Let the Holy Spirit talk about Jesus to you and what he has done. Then put your faith. Leave it out. Allow the Holy Ghost to leave it out in you. Put your faith in what he has done. And as you do that, you just discover things begin to work. The Holy Ghost will begin to work out things. He will begin to make things, give you favor in all your ways. He will allow mercy to be coming across your path. Even what you don't deserve, the Spirit of God will be bringing it to you, because you have put your faith in him that died and resurrected for you. When you are believed, you will still be in control. Not be talking nonsense. Say, God, where are you looking? Where bolongoge? Or what power, mama mi lowo? No, it's not him. God is not a murderer. That's the devil. Eh? When all that happened to Job happened, he thought it was God. Was it God? No. The devil wants to turn him against God. He will not succeed in turning you against God in Jesus' name. But look through the scripture, you see men, women that knew God, they stand in time of trial. Remember Anna the prophetess in Luke chapter 2? You remember? Anna the prophetess. He was a widow. How many years? 84 years. So how did he spend his, how did she spend her widowhood? Serving the Lord. She wasn't going around looking for men to carry her. Eh? We didn't even hear whether she has children. She didn't say, I cannot afford to die childless. So, can you consider buy me some kitty bima? Just that somebody should sleep with me and I have children. She abandoned herself to the Lord. Why? Because she knew him. She knew him. She knew that there is a hope. Eh? The hope of resurrection, where she will live with God eternally. That all these things on the earth does not count. Do you really know him? There are levels of knowing God, as I conclude. You can be a babe in Christ. 1 John chapter 2, verses 12 to 14. You know God, but you know him as a babe. That is, as Matthew 7, 7. Eh? You are asking for things and it's given to you. You know, when you are newly born again, we enjoy that a lot. Eh? Adu among bagan, we ain't a bash fire here from Jesus. Some of us are at that level. So when difficulty comes, I know I never signed for this one. No. You are still a child of God, but you can grow in your knowledge of God. He said, I write unto you, children, because you have known the Father. Abi, your sins are forgiven, you have known the Father. So he gives you things that you need. But you know, children have a lot of problems. Abi, if they here now, if you didn't put them downstairs, what would they be doing? They will scatter this place. One can come and begin to piss here. He doesn't know, you know nothing concerning. He begins to roll on. You know, we do funny things, even though we are born again, because we are still at it as babes. We know him as babes, as father. But you can grow, you can improve. You can grow on to know him by applying your faith in him. Eh? That's what they call sanctification. You can grow to become a young man. Young men are experienced in warfare. Children don't know how to fight. Abi, you have to fight for them. But young men, they have grown to know how to fight spiritual battles. But that's not the end. You can also become fathers. What are fathers described as? Two times, he said, you have known him who is from the beginning. These people are experienced in the deep knowledge of Jesus Christ, the resurrected Lord and glorified Savior. Him who is from beginning. John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the Word, was the Word was God. You have known him who is from the beginning. Brethren, the more you know the Lord Jesus Christ, not in the flesh. You know, some of us know him in the flesh. So when we come to church, you say, Jesus turned water to wine. So, Oluwa, that wine is in Ayemi. When he was here, he did this. Lord, that miracle. That one, Najara, it was just a taste of what he came to do for us. After he died, resurrected, and glorified, you have greater benefits. You know what? Go read John 14, 12 to 14. He said, very, very, verily I say unto you, I'm concluding. The works that I do, you shall do also. And why? Because I go unto my Father. So we will be able to enjoy greater because Jesus was living, he will finish the work, he will resurrect, and then he will be seated with Baba on high. So there is Lord, and he imparts the Holy Spirit to us to cause us to do this work. Sister, what level are you in your knowledge of God? Are you still a babe? Or you are not even started. You have not put your faith in him for salvation. Excuse me. No, religion will not take you, will not help you to enjoy God as you should. You are praying, you are fasting, you are giving tithes, you are doing everything. But you must have a personal relationship like Paul had on the way to Damascus. Will you allow him to do that in your life today? And become a child. Then are you a child and you want to become a young man? You want to grow to stop all these foolish things of running around from pillar to post. Stop picking. You know, children can pick dirt and begin to eat. Babes, they will carry your shoe and put it in their mouth. That's why they have diarrhea many times, those ones that are crawling. And they will say, nah, any, because they pick dirt, they eat. If they see shit, they will put it in their mouth. As a baby in Christ, you'll be eating rubbish if you don't grow. So stop feeding on junks. Grow your knowledge of God and who you are in him so that you can be successful. Look, spiritual warfare is not what you will fight. Jesus has fought and won for you on the cross. He said it is finished. So what he's calling you to do is to stand from the vintage of finished work and receive. And just begin to enjoy. Say, Lord, thank you. Go and look at how the apostles pray. He said, Colossians chapter 1, Ephesians, it says, giving thanks unto the Father who has made it meet for us to be partakers of the inheritance with the saints in life, who has delivered us, not Oluwagba me, to me sile. He said, give thanks because he has delivered you. Ephesians 1:3 says, we are blessed with all blessings in heavenly places in Christ. You are blessed already. Don't run around saying you want blessing and then they begin to mess you up. You are delivered. You don't need to pay deliverance money anywhere. You just tell God. You thank God. If you seek, know God who he is. What is parish here now? So you just tell, Lord, I thank you because I'm free. You know, because of time, I did give full testimony of what happened to me. I just thank God. The day my eyes will go to open, Baba has finished my case on the cross now. Say, asthma, you are gone. Nobody did deliverance for me. Nobody prayed for healing anymore. I just chewed up and I begin to thank him that I'm free. That's your state. You're already delivered. So grow in the knowledge of what Christ has done for you and enjoy it. And continue to grow to become a father, to be productive, to be other children for God. And so it shall be for you in Jesus' name. Let's be on our feet. And let's begin to appreciate the Lord for this wonderful time that we have had in his presence. Do you know God? Do you want to know him? Can you begin to pray? Can we begin to pray? Say, thanking God that he has revealed himself to us through Jesus Christ. Thanking God that he has revealed himself to us through Jesus Christ. He's a loving God. He's a God who is not judging us, but judged our enemy. He judged the devil. Thank God that he has judged the devil for you. He has judged sin for you. He has judged sicknesses for you. He has judged oppression for you. Begin to appreciate God. Begin to appreciate God. Begin to appreciate God. Begin to appreciate the Lord. Oh, riboshende matanda la bashiri wahika sede. Jena maliba sanda kuna maila biri besede matanda la bashara kasede. Yalika shanda motendere bosede. Ask the Lord to keep opening your eyes, to enlighten your eyes so that you will know him more and more. Ask that you will know him more and more. That you want to grow from being a baby in Christ to become a young man and to become a father, a mother. Pray, oh Lord. Yeri kasanda la bashori, zenda kayaila sedi matanda buna maila shiri, zonda maika siri matanda luba shiri matada kasiri mahuka, jena malike sende moriba shanda robo sedi. Baba, I thank you. Loving God. Thank him because he's a loving God. He's not counting your sins against you. He's not counting the sins of your father, your mother against you. That's a wicked God who will not be visiting the sin of your father who you don't know against you. Thank God because you are free from generational curses. You are free from generational sins. Appreciate God that he has judged Satan for you. He has judged diseases. He has judged sin for you. Appreciate the Lord. Appreciate the Lord. Thank him because he has brought unto you the gift of righteousness. You don't have to struggle to please God anymore. You don't have to struggle to keep the law. Jesus brought righteousness for you as a gift. Receive it from him. Say, Lord, I receive your righteousness. I receive your robe of righteousness this morning. I believe that you brought it for me. You bought it. Jesus bought it with his blood. He bought righteousness for you. You are righteous. If you put your faith in Christ this morning, it's righteous. Satan also will see you as righteous because Jesus' righteousness is your righteousness. Appreciate the Lord. Appreciate the Lord. Appreciate the Lord. I want you to begin to pray that the Lord will help you to continue to know him. That you will continue to know him. That you will be strong so that you can be strong.
You can be strong physically. Ah, you can be strong spiritually. You can be strong emotionally. You will not be crashing, developing depression. A child of God having depression is because you are not strong emotionally to handle things that happen to you. Pray that the Lord will strengthen you. He will strengthen your spirit. He will strengthen your emotion. Pray that all the challenges that are facing you, God will grant you grace to stand. Ah, riba bala shanda koribo sede. Strength to stand in time of trial, in time of tribulation. Ah, tell the Lord, I'm going to stand. Help me to be like Daniel, like Shadrach, like Meshach, and Abednego. Daniel did not, because they were thrown into the lions then to be killed, stop to pray, stop his relationship with God. Tell the Lord, Lord, please help me to stand. Help me to stand. The knowledge of you that Daniel had, let me have it also. Help me to have it. They have the knowledge of the Holy One of Israel, the Son of the Living God, that he died for them. They were seeing it afar off. We have seen it now. It has happened. They were looking to it. We are looking back at it. Appreciate God. Tell him, oh Lord, I put my faith in you this morning. I receive strength. I receive strength. Strength to overcome temptations in my working place, in the neighborhood, in the church. Temptations to do what you know you should not do as a child of God. Temptation to use your self-effort to make yourself rich. You want to do it your way. You don't want to wait for God. Ah, Lord, please help me. Help me, Lord. Help me, Lord. I want to bear the fruit of the Spirit. I don't want to be angry anymore. You are the one that can do it in me. I believe that you live in me, the Son of the Living God. Let your Spirit work it out in me now. The Spirit of the Living God. The Spirit of the Living God. Yes, to produce the fruit of the Holy Spirit in me. The love of God, that I will be able to love my enemy. I will love my husband, whatever he does to me. Ah, the joy of salvation, the joy in time of tribulation, peace in storms, I receive from you. Holy Spirit of God, in the name of Jesus, grace to suffer long. Ah, Baba, grace to suffer long, to be temperate, self-control, faith, I receive from you. In the name of Jesus, thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. You are here and you are saying, Lord, I just need your help. I want this strength to be able to stand against temptations. You know what you have been facing? Different areas of temptation. You want God to help you, that today you are receiving strength from Calvary, from the resurrected Lord. I want to pray with you. Maybe yours is strength to stand the challenges you are facing, to stand your trials and temptations. Can I see your hand up? You want me to pray with you? To stand your trials, your temptations, to stand it. Please come to the altar and let us quickly pray together. You want the Lord to promote you? You don't want to remain a baby Christian, running from pillar to post. All over the place you are there. And there's one mountain here, there's one. Because you are a baby in Christ, the Lord will promote you this morning. And you will become young men. You will receive strength to fight and overcome in the name of Jesus. That strength comes from the
holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient world.